Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for joining us again today, as usual. You know, at times like this, things that divide us in normal times just seem so much less important. And we're very much reminded of that again today. Right now, all of us are just human beings united in a fight against this virus. And as we know, the Prime Minister, as well as leading the UK government's response, is currently in hospital fighting his own personal battle against coronavirus. I chaired a meeting of the Scottish Government's Cabinet this morning and we recorded our very best wishes to him. And so now, and I'm sure I do this on behalf of all of Scotland, I want to send every good wish to him, to his fiancée and to his whole family. We are all willing you on, Boris. Get well soon. The Prime Minister's admission to intensive care, of course, is a terrible reminder of the fact that, as I mentioned here yesterday, this virus simply doesn't discriminate. Absolutely anybody can get it. And of course, absolutely anyone can pass the virus on to other people. And that is why we have put in place such severe lockdown restrictions. And for the avoidance of any doubt, let me state very clearly how I expect people to be behaving. People should be staying at home except for essential purposes such as one session of exercise a day and a trip to buy essential food or medicines from the shops. People who are displaying COVID-19 symptoms should self-isolate, not going out at all for 7 days, and members of their household should self-isolate for 14 days. People should not be gathering outside in groups of more than two unless they're part of the same household, and people should not be visiting each other's homes. And all non-essential businesses should be closed. These restrictions can, of course, be enforced by the police. And I understand, I've said this many times before, I acutely understand that they are incredibly tough measures, particularly as the weather gets better. And these measures would have seemed unimaginable even just a few weeks ago. But I want to stress again today, they are vital to reduce the number of people who fall sick and they are vital to save lives. So once again, let me, from the bottom of my heart, thank everyone who is doing the right thing and staying at home. By staying at home, all of us are helping to slow the spread of the virus. All of us are helping to protect our National Health Service and all of us are helping to save lives. I also want to stress today that the Prime Minister's illness will not affect, as people would expect, the good cooperation on key strategic decisions which takes place where it's appropriate between the Scottish Government, the UK Government and the other devolved governments. My ministers have for a number of weeks joined UK ministers for regular meetings on health, public services and the economy, and that will continue. Indeed, Joe Fitzpatrick, the Minister for Public Health, is currently taking part in a discussion with Matt Hancock and others. And last week, prior to his admission to hospital, myself and other First Ministers had written to the Prime Minister suggesting an early COBRA meeting to assess the impact of the lockdown and to discuss next steps. So we will all continue to work our very hardest and to work together to do everything we can to beat this virus. I've got two other issues I want to cover before I hand over to Fiona McQueen, the Chief Nursing Officer, who joins us today, and then to the Health Secretary. Firstly, I want to update you as usual on some of the key statistics in relation to COVID-19 in Scotland. I can confirm that as at 9 o'clock this morning, there have now been 4,229 positive cases confirmed. That is an increase of 268 from yesterday's figures. As always, let me be clear that these numbers will be an underestimate. These are cases that have a laboratory confirmation. A total of 199 people last night were in intensive care with confirmed or suspected COVID-19. That is the same figure as the one reported yesterday, although, of course, it is important to note that it will not necessarily be the same people. A total of 1,751 patients, including those in intensive care, are in hospitals across Scotland with confirmed or suspected COVID-19, and that is an increase of 152 from yesterday's. I can also provide figures for deaths that have sadly been registered in the last 24 hours. As I said both on Sunday and on Monday, relatively few COVID-19 deaths, four in total, were registered over the weekend, reflecting the fact that National Records of Scotland's reporting system is not yet fully in operation for 7 days a week. Work is underway to change that. As a result of that, a relatively large number of COVID-19 deaths were registered yesterday. So I can report today that in the last 24 hours, 74 deaths have been registered as being caused by COVID-19. That takes the total number of deaths in Scotland now to 296. It's also worth saying, since this is relevant to a subject I'm about to cover, that these deaths will sometimes, although not always, include deaths of confirmed cases which have happened in community settings such as care homes. And the report we will be publishing tomorrow will include fuller figures on those deaths in the community where COVID-19 is presumed rather than confirmed. Now, I always focus on the statistics in these media conferences because they are important to give an overall sense of how the virus is spreading. But I want to say again today that every time I read out these statistics, I'm acutely aware that every death is much more than a statistic. Every death represents an individual human being. And I want once again to express my deepest condolences to everyone who has lost friends, family or loved ones. And I also want again to thank all those who are working in our health and care services. Your compassion, your commitment and your expertise is appreciated by all of us all of the time, but never more so than it is now. That appreciation definitely includes our nurses and our midwives. Today is the World Health Organization's World Health Day, and they have decided this year to focus on the contribution made by nurses and midwives. And so it is appropriate that Chief Nursing Officer Fiona McQueen is here today. She will shortly give an update on NHS Louisa Jordan in Glasgow, and also about student nurses who volunteered to join the NHS workforce early to help us tackle COVID-19. The Cabinet Secretary will then talk about the £5.3 million of additional support we're announcing for community pharmacies who are having to meet unprecedented demands at this particular time. And I want to take the opportunity to say a particular and a special thanks to all of them. Before they do that, though, the second issue I want to cover is what is an understandable concern around support for those living and working in our care homes. The Care Inspectorate is in regular contact with care homes, and it has confirmed, for example, in relation to Castle View, that appropriate infection control procedures are in place there. The Care Inspectorate will continue to provide advice and support to that home and to others. And the Scottish Government is working with the Inspectorate to understand the broader impact of COVID-19 on the care sector so that we can support health and care workers as well as possible. Care workers are included in those key workers who should have access to testing, and the Health Secretary is also looking to see how testing of care workers can be increased as our overall testing capacity, including for NHS staff, is increased. The importance and dedication of those who work in the care sector is recognised by me, and it is recognised by the government. Where there have been issues, for example, with PPE, we are working to resolve that. And as I said yesterday, we have already distributed 6 million items of PPE. Care workers are doing a remarkable job in the most difficult of circumstances. I want today to thank all of you, but more importantly, promise that we will do all we can to support you. And in many ways, that brings me back to one of the points I made at the start. Clearly, there are some forms of support for care workers and for people in the health and care services more generally, which only government can provide. And that includes, of course, the provision of PPE. But everyone, every single one of us can and must do our bit. All of us can support health and care service workers by doing the right thing and by staying at home wherever possible. By doing that, we can all play our part in slowing the spread of this virus. We can give our health and care services a chance to cope with the demands that are and will continue to be placed on them. And we can all do our bit to save lives. So thank you, each and every one of you, once again, for doing all of that. And now let me hand over to the Chief Nursing Officer, Fiona McQueen, who's going to cover some of the topics I mentioned earlier.
First Minister, thank you very much indeed. And as the First Minister said, all across our country, our health and social care workforce are doing what they do day in, day out, and work tirelessly to provide outstanding, compassionate care to the people across Scotland. The Louisa Jordan, the NHS Louisa Jordan, is going to be part of that. It's part of our national response to get ready to provide that safe, effective, person-centred care to people who have the COVID infection. So last Tuesday, 7 o'clock, we had vans and vans and vans of construction workers who joined the then NHS workers who were there, who were planning the hospital. And since then, whilst they may have left personally, construction workers have not left that site. So within the NHS Louisa Jordan, since 7 o'clock last Tuesday, we have had workers there working 24 hours a day, working tirelessly to provide what we hope will be a hospital that we may never need. But what it will be is a hospital that will give us security and affirmation that whatever happens to the people of Scotland, we will have a response and we will be able to provide that care for them. I've seen myself the what seems to be miles of copper piping so that every single bedhead will have the oxygen that patients may need. We've had over 8,000 pieces of medical equipment ordered and 23,000 square feet of flooring. It is truly beginning to take shape and beginning to look like a hospital. We couldn't do that without staff, and what we're planning to do is, within the first section, is have 300 beds ready for people to care for them, and if we need to, it could go up to over 1,000. Part of that preparedness to care for the people of Scotland who may contract COVID. We couldn't do this, of course, without staff, and whether it's been staff who have been SEC staff, the Army who helped us set up, but now is being led by Jill Young, our Chief Executive of the NHS Louisa Jordan, and staff right across the range of services, whether it's our architects, our engineers, our porters, our special advisors, including infection prevention and control, are working tirelessly to do that. I would like to say an extra special thank you to the nurses who are planning to work within the Louisa Jordan. They will be there 24 hours a day, caring for patients. And today, in terms of the World Health Day of Health, recognising the contribution of nurses and midwives, but in this case, we're talking about nurses. I've been hugely impressed and honoured by the contribution our student nurses have volunteered to make. Our regulator, our universities across Scotland, our NHS boards have all worked together tirelessly to make sure that our senior students who are at the end of their education can join our NHS workforce. It is optional and I recognise that not everyone will be able to do it, but we've had an amazing response from our third and fourth year students who have offered to step up and come into our health service ahead of when they graduate so that they can be part of the workforce and help what is our incredible response for patients. So this week we're seeing over 2,000 of them being deployed. Some of them won't start till next week, but the majority have started yesterday and today. And it's a real thrill for me to see their compassionate care and their professionalism that they have in stepping up. Nurses can only work effectively if they're part of a truly multidisciplinary team, and often our unhidden facilities and support staff are clearly indispensable. But today, a big thank you to our Nurses of Scotland and our Student Nurses of Scotland for stepping up and giving me the confidence that they will be ready to provide that person-centred compassionate care when it's needed.
Thank you very much indeed, Fiona. Can I hand over now to the Health Secretary?
Thank you, First Minister. Can I also extend my personal thanks and gratitude to all our healthcare staff, but again, as colleagues have said on World Health Day, particularly to our nurses and midwives, including those student nurses and midwives who are joining us from yesterday. Today, I want to outline steps that we are taking to support community pharmacies. Community pharmacies are very much a central part of our primary and community healthcare workforce and services. They are, in many ways, where most of us will secure the healthcare and support that we need. I want to thank all community pharmacy teams for their incredible hard work throughout this pandemic and in the weeks ahead. They're providing an invaluable service, ensuring patients in Scotland continue to receive vital medicines in what are unprecedented times. Working with Community Pharmacy Scotland, we've agreed an initial package of £5.3 million in funding for community pharmacies to help them meet some of the costs that they will undergo in terms of responding to COVID-19. This will address their unparalleled levels of activity that they are undertaking through the pharmacy network, through items dispensed and consultations, and the treatment that they are providing through what is now an extended across Scotland minor ailment service. It will cover the costs of equipment, adaptations to premises, additional staffing, and locum cover when they have sickness absence. Even in the exceptional circumstances that we're in, I am pleased that they have responded so positively to my request of them that they remain open on Good Friday and Easter Monday, where it is possible for them to do so. This will help to alleviate some of the pressure from our out-of-hour services, and as I've said earlier in previous briefings, our GP services too, when it is possible for them to do so, will remain open on Friday and Monday. We will meet in full additional costs incurred by community pharmacies to support the NHS at this time. Finally, I'd like to stress once again, as is the case across all of the health service, that pharmacists are working incredibly hard right now. I understand there are times when we are queuing for our medicines or queuing for advice that we can become frustrated by those queues. But I would ask everyone to please understand that our community pharmacies and our pharmacists are part of that healthcare workforce that I know you support, and they need your support as much as any other part of it does. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Health Secretary. Now, I'm going to go to questions as usual, and entirely understandably, we've got a very long list of journalists wishing to ask questions, so if I can make my usual plea to be as brief as possible in questions, we'll try to be as brief as possible in answers and to avoid duplication where possible. Firstly, Peter McMahon, ITV Border.
First Minister, Stena, who have a big base in Cairn Ryan, as you know, have furloughed, horrible word, 600 people and made 150 redundancies across the UK. They say that's unavoidable because of COVID-19. I just wondered if you think, first of all, that the company, a big company like that, is right to do it. And secondly, what can the Scottish Government do to try and help maintain lifeline services, but also to support the local economy, which is probably in the southwest of Scotland going to be hit pretty hard by this?
So thank you for that question. I'm going to try and avoid going into the specific details of specific companies, although I try and address the general question you raise. I don't underestimate the impact of this crisis on businesses of all shapes and sizes and in all sectors of our economy. That is why the UK government scheme that allows companies to furlough, and it's not an attractive word, workers, rather than make them redundant, is so crucial, and allows them to pay, continue to pay the majority of their salary. And I would encourage businesses to continue to take any steps that protects employment as far as possible, and effectively protects the productive capacity of the economy, because we hope that at the end of this crisis, whenever that is, some of the businesses that have been affected will be able to start operating normally again as quickly as possible. But that will not be possible for every one, and unfortunately there will be some businesses that find that impact much harder to deal with. The Scottish Government has already put in place schemes. We've passed on all of the consequential funding from UK Government announcements. That totals a £2.2 billion package of support, mainly through grants to companies and support through the business rates scheme. But we are having ongoing discussions with business organisations and, where appropriate, with individual companies to see what more the Scottish Government will do, and we will continue to do that. The final point I would make is the one you raise about lifeline services and the strategic importance of certain companies, and Stena, of course, will fall into that category. We want particularly to work with countries. We've already done this with essential flights from our islands, for example. There are the same issues with the south of Scotland, so we're very happy to have focused and tailored discussions with companies that are helping to maintain those lifeline services. And I'll certainly raise this issue particularly with Michael Matheson, the Transport Secretary, and also the Economy Secretary, to see whether there's more we can do, either with Stena particularly or around the strategic infrastructure of the south of Scotland in particular. Lisa Summers from BBC.
Yes, you talk about the priority that care workers are, and you say that you are doing your best to get supplies to them and that you have distributed millions of supplies to them and that you're planning to put in place a testing regime. Can you tell us when that will start, how many care workers you're testing so far? And also, if you are doing your best to get supplies to them, is it not time to do something like get the army in to help deliver those supplies? Because care workers are telling us they don't have that provision now, and that is really worrying them.
So these are really important questions. I'll perhaps Fiona or Jean will want to add to what I say. But can I say we're very grateful for it. We already have logistic support here in St Andrew's House being provided by the army to help us with some of these logistical issues and challenges that we're facing. And that is very important and very valued assistance. Can I take the two issues one by one? On testing, that is underway. We are, and I've covered this in some detail at briefings before, we'll give an update in due course around some of the numbers here. But testing capacity is increasing with literally every day that passes. Right now, we have already started testing NHS and care workers, and where it is appropriate, their immediate family members, because if it's not them that have the symptoms, but they're isolating because a family member does, it's the family member that needs to be tested. And I said yesterday, already more than 5,000 people fall into that category. That prioritisation already includes care workers, but we will be taking steps, and the Health Secretary will be doing this later today, of reminding NHS boards that care workers need to be given priority there as well. Obviously, as the testing capacity increases, the numbers of people that will be able to go through that increase as well. So this is something that is underway, is work in progress, and has a real focus on the part of the government. On supply of PPE, I'll hand over to the Health Secretary. We have regular, very detailed discussions about this, because I recognise the importance of this issue for everybody who is working in a frontline capacity with people who either on a confirmed basis or a suspected basis have COVID-19. There are three different issues on PPE. There is supply. Can we get the equipment that we need in sufficient supply? As the Health Secretary said before, we have healthy supplies, but they are under pressure, and the global supply chain is under pressure. So that is an issue of ongoing concern and focus for us. Secondly, distribution, and we have already taken steps to streamline and speed up the distribution, and that work continues. We've set up an email hotline, so any member of the workforce, as well as any member of the public who wants to raise concerns, can do so quickly and directly. And thirdly, there is guidance and education and training about how to effectively use PPE. There was new guidance issued by Health Protection Scotland for health and care last week. And of course, it's important that that is disseminated properly through the workforce. So maybe, Fiona, do you want to say a word about that in terms of the health and care workforce? And I'll come on to the Health Secretary about some of the supply issues.
Absolutely. And as the First Minister said, it's vital that our health and care workers have access to the right PPE. The guidance was issued last week, and actually the World Health Organization today has published a paper examining actually the use of masks, but it affirms the guidance that was issued last week as being the correct guidance to issue. We know that there are some areas where the distribution hasn't quite got down to the final area, but are confident that we're accessing where that's not happening and putting measures in place to make it right. So what we do want is every single member of health and care staff to have a confidence that they have the right equipment with them so that they can use it when they're delivering care to their patients and their clients.
Lisa, as you know, the care sector is a sector where the services that are delivered is a partnership between us as Scottish Government, our colleagues in local authorities, and the independent sector. So in terms of both testing and PPE, ordering and supply means that that partnership needs to work as well as it can. We took responsibility for the ordering and the distribution of PPE to the social care sector in order to streamline that operation. There is a direct route both for ordering and for distribution. But that means, in order to make those orders, both colleagues in local government and in the private care sector need to advise us of what is needed, and then we can take it from there. I will be speaking again this afternoon to Donald McCaskill from Scottish Care. I spoke to him last on Friday. I'll be having my weekly call with COSLA in terms of the delivery of social care in the areas that they are responsible for again today. And we will carry forward looking at some of those issues that are being raised to ensure that we are doing everything we can to address the supply of PPE, the right PPE, and that people are confident in what is being supplied to them and how to make use of that. The final thing I'd say is that as well as that streamlined ordering and distribution that has been in place now for 2 weeks, we also have that daily monitoring, both of the supply chain, of the distribution, and also of that dedicated email address where people are raising individual concerns with us, and that itself has ministerial oversight. So we are working hard to make sure that we can do everything we can, and where we need to make improvements, that we make those improvements.
Okay, thank you. Can I go to Ross Govans at STV?
Yes, First Minister. Just a quick follow-up on PPE. I know you've covered it extensively there. Is it the case that there are still problems in the home care and the care sector with PPE? We also heard from the Police Federation today, who've set up their own advisory group to look at how officers can be offered protective equipment. Isn't it the case, with so many problems still with PPE, this is never going to be fully resolved?
We're working hard to resolve issues. What I would say, Ross, and I think it is actually a very fair question to put, such is the importance of this and such is the understandable anxiety people on the front line have, is I suspect we will always be having to do more to reassure people. Supply is never going to be something that we can relax over because of the global pressure on supply chains, and we're constantly looking internationally and domestically for how we can increase supply. And as Fiona has alluded to, you know, PPE is only effective if it is used properly and the right equipment is being used by the right workers in the right context. So this is something we will never take our eye off the ball on. And as you said in relation to the police, there are wider issues here about the wider public sector. It's something, you know, if I just reflect on, you know, the last 24 hours in my own work, you know, I chaired a resilience meeting last night where this was a key focus of discussion. The Scottish Cabinet discussed it at length today. I've had a multitude of discussions in between. So this remains an issue of intense focus because we understand the absolute priority. And I encourage everybody again, because my final point is, for as long as anybody feels concerned about this, whether that concern is subjective or objective, we will continue to work hard to try to allay those concerns. So use that email address. We'll tweet it out on the Scottish Government Twitter feed this afternoon so that people know it is there, and that's a place to go. If you can't get your issues resolved through your management or your normal workplace, make sure you come to us with these concerns and we'll do everything we can to resolve them. Peter Smith, ITV.
First Minister, just the first question to you, First Minister. On the 18th of March, I'd asked you about a whistleblower we had in Scottish Ambulance Service complaining about a lack of protective equipment, and you'd said that if anyone has concerns, they can come to me. The next day, the union that represents care workers and home care workers say that they wrote to you saying that they needed their members to have more testing done and more protective equipment. They say they haven't actually heard a reply from you at all since then. I know you were asked about the number of tests that have been done for care workers yesterday. I wonder if you do know yet today. Do we know how many care workers have been tested and when did that begin? And second question is for the Chief Nursing Officer, is about a letter that you wrote on Sunday to COSLA. You were saying that care workers and community nurses, your recommendation was that they needed, if they were visiting patients, they needed gloves and aprons, but no face mask, as long as the patient was not showing any symptoms of coronavirus and they could keep 2 metres back. I've heard from home care workers and community nurses who are displaying a great deal of anxiety over this. They're worried that either they could get the virus or they could pass it on to vulnerable people. They're concerned that was a recommendation based on supply availability and not on the science.
I'll hand over to Fiona in a second. All of the advice we're giving on these issues is based on the science. I've been candid, I think, twice already in this session about the concerns we have, and every government in the world will probably have similar concerns right now about supply chains, but we work on that in a very focused way. And I'll hand over to Fiona in a second about the guidance and the scientific basis for that. Because in relation to your first question, I mean, I think we've had this conversation before. I don't want anybody feeling that they have to whistleblow to the media. This is not a kind of normal political gotcha game here. Everybody is focused on doing the right thing here. If there's a letter that hasn't had a formal response yet, I will check that out later. But all of us, myself included, are working really hard on all of these things. And I want people with any concerns to be able to raise them directly. That's why I've just spoken about and will draw attention again to the email address so that people can come directly to ministers if their concerns are not being resolved. All of us have a shared interest in making sure that those who are working so hard on the front line have the support of government, the support of their managers locally, and we do everything we can to protect them. Of course, there are going to be glitches in that. There are going to be issues that arise. There are going to be issues that are sometimes quite difficult to resolve, but the absolute determination of all of us is to do the right thing, and I don't want anybody to be either in any doubt about that or to feel in any way that they can't come directly to us to make sure that these things are addressed. Pura, on the guidance.
Okay, thanks. So I was asked over the weekend to help COSLA because we had had a conversation with the trade unions last week about the guidance and what it meant and how we were going to get the absolute right equipment to staff so that they felt confident in doing their work. And we had a wide-ranging discussion about that. So in particular, I was asked at the weekend because there were a number of queries and one local authority in particular who was suggesting that all staff would need to wear a mask, home care staff would need to wear a mask at all times. Now, the guidance is carefully considered. The infection prevention and control communities and specialists and experts across the UK have agreed this guidance. It's been supported by the medical academies and the Royal Colleges as being appropriate given the evidence at this time, the scientific evidence. And that is where you're caring for someone who doesn't have COVID or isn't suspected to have COVID, then your normal PPE, and that would be apron and gloves, would be appropriate if you're delivering care. Where the guidance went a bit further than the science was to say, however, if you're on your rounds, whether you're a nurse or a home care worker, because people were anxious that perhaps nurses were getting more than home care workers, and that's not the case. If you go into a house and you've perhaps been there every day and your client has been fit and well but is developing signs, then we're expecting there to be a mask available for that worker at that time. The guidance is quite clear that the mask is not necessary and not essential when you're caring for someone who does not have COVID positive or symptoms of COVID. So that continuous dry cough that is new and the high temperature. So I understand that people are anxious and I understand that people can misinterpret or not understand what we're asking of them. And that's why that dialogue's continuing with the trade unions through COSLA and through the academies so that we can support people. The guidance has been based on science and evidence and not on supply.
And I think that's an assurance that we want to keep repeating to people. It's the safety of all of you working at the front line that matters to me, that matters to Fiona, Jean and everybody. And that's what will always drive these decisions. Glen Campbell from BBC Radio.
First Minister, with Boris Johnson in intensive care, is it clear to you who's running the UK government, especially when it comes to national security decisions? Because we know that during this emergency, Russia, for instance, is testing UK national security.
Well, as we heard last night, the Foreign Secretary is deputising for the Prime Minister where that is necessary, and I trust and have confidence that the appropriate arrangements are in place. As I said earlier on, we continue to have all of the normal routes and strands of cooperation, and that will continue. I think it's not appropriate for me to say more, obviously, because I don't have the information about the Prime Minister's condition and how that over the next period may affect the arrangements that are in place in the UK government. But I heard Michael Gove on the radio this morning, I think, say that Downing Street will give updates on that as appropriate. So I have no concerns about the arrangements right now in terms of the running of the UK government, and I hope and trust that that will continue to be the case. And I think at the moment, all of us, our main thoughts and wishes are for the health of the Prime Minister. Phil McDonald from Global Radio.
First Minister, could I ask about intensive care beds? In recent weeks, we've heard about Scotland doubling its capacity to 360 beds and then on to 700. With 199 people in intensive care, can I ask how many beds are available right now? How close are we to hitting capacity? And do you have an update on the number of ventilators in Scotland?
We have the ability for, the Health Secretary will give some more detailed information. I think at the moment, just under 600 intensive care beds. We have plenty spare capacity right now, but I say that not in a way to sound or make anybody feel complacent. We are going to see continued rise in demand for intensive care, which is why we continue to take steps to build that capacity even further. But I want people to be assured that as of now, there is plenty of capacity in our intensive care units for the demands that are placed upon it. Jean, do you want to add?
Thank you very much. We have a surge capacity at this point of 585 ICU beds. That is beds with ventilator and ventilator capacity. From today's figures, we know that at the moment, as at 9 a.m. this morning, we had a total of 264 patients in ICU. That would be for both COVID-19 and for other conditions. So that means at 9 a.m. this morning, we had 321 unoccupied ICU beds, i.e. the capacity. We are, however, so that 585, I think people will see from our original position, has trebled our ICU capacity, and we are therefore on our way to the quadrupling of that, which is what we have set out to do. The ventilator supply continues to come through in terms of the orders that we have placed, but also in the discussion that we are having with the UK government, that continues discussion. My colleague, Mr. Fitzpatrick, will be undertaking that as we speak to look at how we can secure an appropriate share of ventilators for Scotland out of that overall UK procurement exercise.
And just finally on that, as well as ICU, we've been working to make sure we've got the right capacity in general hospital beds as well. We said at the outset that we wanted to have 3,000 beds across our existing hospital network dedicated to COVID-19 patients. What Fiona has reported on today around the NHS Louisa Jordan is adding capacity over and above that. So I reported earlier on that we have a total of 1,751 patients in hospital. That includes ICU with suspected or confirmed COVID-19. So again, we have plenty of capacity within our hospitals, ICU and general, but we remain very focused on making sure as we see this virus continue to spread, the impact grow towards the peak of it, that we continue to be in the best possible position. But again, it's always an opportunity to stress the importance of the advice, because that is the capacity, all of us, and it's for government working with our partners to make sure we've got the capacity where it needs to be, but all of us have a part to play in reducing the demand for that capacity, and that is why the stay at home message is so fundamentally important. Alan Smith from Bower.
Hi, good afternoon. Just a question in regards to the guidance on PPE for home care staff. Unison claims that the guidance issued by the Chief Nursing Officer actually contradicts the UK-wide PPE guidance and puts Scottish home and social care workers at a greater risk than their UK counterparts. So just wondering why there is specific guidance for Scotland, and if you how do you respond to Unison's claims that it contradicts the UK-wide guidance?
Hello, Fiona.
So I'm confident that the letter that I issued was in keeping with the UK-wide guidance, so that we have UK-wide guidance. Today we have asked for Unison and Unite to present to us the evidence that they believe, where they believe that we are not supporting our care at home staff, so that they can do that. And we'll have that ongoing dialogue and discussion. So wanting to keep talking to them, I have every confidence that the letter issued is in keeping with the guidance and that it's evidence-based. And I would expect local application of that to be, as I said earlier, if going into a client or a patient, someone is not expected to be COVID positive or showing symptoms, that that worker would have the equipment with them so that they can wear it as appropriate.
OK, thank you very much. Neil Pooran from PA.
Thank you. Could I ask, what are the current estimates of the percentage of the population in Scotland which is infected with coronavirus right now? Has that changed recently now that we've had several weeks of data from the real world as opposed to the computer modelling?
We're not able to give that information right now. We are, and we've spoken about this before here, we've started to do surveillance testing, which will allow us to get a better sense of this as the days and weeks progress. What we do know is that over the last number of days, the percent of all the tests that have been done, the percentage that have been positive has been increasing slightly. So that would suggest, as the other figures suggest, that there is an increasing spread of the virus. But there are still lots we don't know yet about this virus, and the data we're gathering now is turning what up until now have been complex, sophisticated computer models into models that are populated with real-time data. And I would hope in the over the next few days we'll be able to give a much more detailed briefing about our current state of understanding of what the virus is doing and what we predict it to do in the weeks ahead. Tom Martin from the Daily Express.
Hi, good afternoon, First Minister. Just returning a follow-up from Alan's question on the supplementary guidance that's been issued to social and care staff. The GMB unions say this is rowing back on previous commitments. So I just want to clarify, is that the case or not?
I think Fiona's covered that. The letter that's been issued is in line, as far as we are concerned, and in keeping with the UK guidance, which Fiona said earlier on, was formulated carefully with input from experts, the medical academies, royal colleges. But if there are, and this is a general point as well as a particular point, and Fiona reflected it in her last answer with reference to Unite and Unison, if people still have concerns about this, we want to understand them so that if there are changes we need to make, we can make them. None of us have any interest here in anything other than getting to a point where all of our frontline staff have confidence in the PPE that they're being provided with and also have confidence in the circumstances in which they're being asked to use it. So anybody with concerns, this is an ongoing issue. We'll continue to engage in dialogue to try to resolve these matters. Andrew Learmonth from The National.
So obviously the Scottish Government published advice yesterday on new construction sector guidance, calling on all non-essential work to close. Despite that, there's still some work going on that would seem non-essential, including in your own constituency, the redevelopment of the Borough Collection. There was work going on there this morning. The redevelopment of an art gallery doesn't necessarily seem like it should be essential. Keir Construction, who are project managing that project for Glasgow City Council, say that they are following the UK government's guidance rather than the Scottish government's guidance. Is there anything the Scottish government can do to stop that project from going ahead? Would you call on Glasgow City Council to urge them to cancel?
I would ask all companies, whether in the construction sector or in any sector, and I think the vast majority of companies are following what I'm about to say, is to be responsible and prioritise the health of your workforce and follow the guidance that is there. We're not giving this guidance for no reason. None of us want to be, certainly as First Minister, knowing the importance of economic activity and construction and elsewhere. I don't want to be giving guidance that says to any company, stop doing what you're doing. But this guidance has been given for the best of reasons, because we judge it is in the interest of slowing down the spread of the virus and helping us do what we are trying to do. So the guidance on construction was updated and issued yesterday, and I would ask all companies to look at that and to follow that. And the guidance more generally around business activity. We know that there are some businesses in the categories that are being told absolutely to close, the pubs and clubs and restaurants, others that are absolutely essential to the ongoing running of the country. In the middle, what we've tried to do is give clear precautionary guidance to businesses that say, if in doubt, put the health of your workers first. Vivian Aitken from The Record.
Good afternoon, First Minister. Today, the Daily Record and many others no doubt carried the stories about the numbers of people dying in nursing homes. There are allegations, however, that in at least one of those nursing homes, staff were denied access to PPE, which was allegedly locked in a cupboard. We've heard similar stories to this throughout this crisis. So my question is, under the emergency powers the Scottish Government has, are there any plans to reprimand, fine, or indeed imprison company bosses who are breaching the PPE guidance and putting their staff and patients at risk?
Well, the emergency legislation will be used, and that will include enforcement where required and where necessary. And I've been very clear on that in general previously, and I will be again today. Obviously, it's not possible for us to respond to anonymous allegations, to use your word. But if there are specific issues that are being raised, if people want to come to us and keep their own identity anonymous and raise issues that we can look into, I am absolutely determined that we do that. The Care Inspectorate, when it comes to care homes, has a vital role to play here. We absolutely want to see those working in care home settings getting the protection that they need. And that means proper provision of PPE, robust infection control procedures. There was guidance much earlier in this outbreak issued to care homes specifically about how they, with their residents, manage this infection properly. So people should have confidence in coming forward if there are issues they want us, or where appropriate, the Care Inspectorate to look into, and we certainly will do that. Libby Brooks from The Guardian.
Hello, First Minister. I just wanted to ask if there's any data available yet on how long people are waiting for assessment since the new community hubs were set up, you know, that work alongside the 111 phone line.
We gave some data yesterday on numbers that had been referred to community hubs from the 111 number. We are going to be publishing more data across a whole range of things, starting later this week and into next week. I will need to check to see what will be published in terms of waiting times for the assessment centres. I'm not sure if Jean is able to add anything just now. This may be something we need to come back to, because it will be amongst the suite of things that we want to give much more information on. But certainly, based on the feedback and the information I have, that new system of 111 for COVID-related queries. Of course, the first port of call for COVID-related advice is the NHS Inform website. But if your symptoms worsen or you need medical assistance, then 111, then to be transferred on to the assessment hubs. That is working well. But of course, if there are issues, we'll work to resolve them. But on the more information, we'll be setting out details hopefully later this week about the routine information that we'll be publishing going forward. Scott McNabb from The Scotsman.
Hello, First Minister. Apologies if this seems a bit morbid, and hopefully it never happens, but given events down south, can you explain the continuity arrangements for leadership of the Scottish Government and Scotland's response to COVID-19 if you were to develop symptoms? And also, how long would you continue before passing over the reins to focus on recovery?
In relation to that second question, obviously I hope the situation doesn't arise, and I'm, you know, taking as many precautions as I reasonably can, given what I have to do for work-related purposes right now to reduce the risk of that, and everybody should be trying to minimise their own risk to that. In relation to how long I would continue to work, for as long as was medically appropriate. I mean, clearly everybody has to make judgments there about their own capacity to work. I want to be leading this operation as effectively and as much on an ongoing basis as possible, but I would make judgments, no doubt, if I needed it, with medical advice about when it was appropriate in the interests of the response to coronavirus, for me to hand over that to somebody else for a period of time. In terms of the arrangements, of course, we have continuity arrangements in place. I won't go into full detail what they are, but in the first instance, if I was, through illness, unable to work, it would be, of course, the Deputy First Minister who stepped in to deputise for me. Helen Puttock from The Times.
I wanted to ask, what, if anything, are you doing to monitor the impact of the lockdown on the mental health of teenagers in particular, and when you will next review the closure of the schools?
We are, I'll maybe hand over to the Health Secretary on mental health issues, but we're acutely aware of the impact of this on mental health, on things like domestic violence, on the wider health impacts. The Interim Chief Medical Officer here yesterday talked about the importance of people with non-COVID symptoms, because other health conditions haven't gone away, of coming forward to get advice, because we are tackling a virus right now, but we've got to be mindful of some of the consequences of the ways in which we are doing that. In terms of the schools, so we said when we announced the lockdown measures just over two weeks ago, that there would be a review around the Easter weekend period, and that review, certainly the Scottish Government has started thinking about the processes that will inform that review. I referred earlier on to the possibility of a COBRA meeting, or the request from First Ministers for a COBRA meeting perhaps next week, so that on a four-nation basis we can discuss that. So that work is already being thought about, but and schools obviously will be part of that because they're part of the measures we have in place right now. But I want to caution against giving anybody the suggestion that these measures are about to be lifted in the near future. You know, I think some people have thought that perhaps after the Easter weekend we'll start to go back to normal. We want to get back to normal as much as possible and as quickly as possible, but we need these measures to be in place long enough to do what they're intended to do. So these things will be carefully considered, but I repeat again what I've always said: we are in this for the long haul, and we need to ask people to cooperate with us on this potentially for the long haul. Jean, do you want to say a word more about mental health?
Yes, thank you, and thanks, Helen. That is a really important question, and one we're very conscious of, about the impact on people's mental health and well-being of the current pandemic, and also the very important restrictions we're asking everyone to abide by. That's not just about our young people, but across our whole population. In terms of young people, we're working very closely with Young Scot in order to get as much messages and support out to young people as we possibly can. Our community mental health services are very focused on the particular issues of anxiety and concern that are being raised, not only amongst young people, but the wider population. I'm sure you'll recall at a previous briefing where I announced additional financial support to expand some of those services, including breathing space. And in addition to that, we're also undertaking a particular piece of work with colleagues in health and social care, looking at the mental health and well-being of our health and social care staff and what more can be done, both in practical terms, but also in providing additional support to them, given the difficulties and the extreme pressure that we are asking them to work under.
Thank you. Tom Peterkin from the P&J.
Good afternoon, First Minister. Going back to the care homes issue, Robert Kilgour of Renaissance Care has said, as well as PPE, not enough staff and residents are getting tested. I wonder what your specific response to that is, the tests issue. And he also said that GPs are telling homes not to admit suspected coronavirus patients to hospital. I wondered if what your reaction to that is, and whether that was the right thing to do.
Well, I'll perhaps hand over to the chief nurse on the latter point, but can I say on that, people should be in hospital if that is the appropriate place for them to be for their clinical care. People should have the most clinically appropriate care. Now, hospital will not be the most clinically appropriate place for everybody to be, but where it is, then they should certainly be there. And on testing, I think I've covered that already. Care workers are amongst the priority groups for health boards to be testing, and we'll be reminding them of that, but we will be testing more NHS and care workers as our testing capacity continues to grow, which it is doing every day. Is there any more you want to say about the appropriateness of care?
I think just confirming what the First Minister said, each individual person needs to be assessed on their own merits. And there are many, this is a virus that's quite a paradox in terms of, for some people there are no apparent symptoms, but particularly for older people who are frail, who have other conditions already affecting them, then it can be quite vicious. And therefore, a decision has to be made. What is best, and how is this person going to best respond? And often, being with the people who are normally caring for them, with good community support from their care home team who know them well, along with the GP and the community nurses, that is often the best solution for that person who has COVID-19. If a decision is made that it would be more appropriate for them to be admitted to hospital for particular reasons that it's believed that they would respond well to, then that would be the decision that would be made. But the decision has to be about that the person who lives in the care home, based on their preferences, based on their predisposing conditions, and the likelihood of the hospital treatment being successful for them. So that's a wide-ranging decision that needs to be made by the team, and it would always be based on the best interest of the person.
Thanks, Fiona. Simon Johnson from The Telegraph.
Hi, First Minister, I just wondered if you had any discussions planned with Dominic Raab, now he's taken over temporarily, whether you have confidence in Mr Raab's ability to lead the country through this until hopefully Boris Johnson gets on his feet. And more generally, we've had some good news about Boris in the last sort of 10 minutes, that he's not on a ventilator and he's in a stable condition. But it has been a terrible week with the Prime Minister in hospital, losing a chief medical officer, and also Michael Gove self-isolating. And I just wondered if you wanted to say something more generally to the country, to people who are feeling worried or concerned.
OK, in terms of Dominic Raab, I've got no immediate plans to speak with him. I will certainly speak with him if it is necessary to do, and I wish him well. You know, the responsibilities that he's bearing with the Prime Minister in hospital are considerable, and all of us in these positions of leadership right now just understand, you know, just how big a deal that is. So I wish him well, and I'm sure he'll do it to the very best of his ability. You've given me some news on the Prime Minister that I hadn't obviously heard, so that sounds positive, but obviously, you know, he will be getting the best possible care. This virus, for some people, as Fiona has just said, is pretty vicious. So I think we continue to give him our best wishes and hope that that path of recovery is a quick one. In terms of the overall question, you know, we are, and I've said this before, we are living in unprecedented times. I, as First Minister, am asking people to do things that I would never have believed that I would have to stand here and ask people to do, to stay at home, not to see your family, not to, if you're a child, not to go to school and see your friends as normal. I understand how difficult this is, but I also understand how anxious people are right now. I know that many people last night of all political persuasions and none, and I include myself in this, would have felt really shaken at the news of the Prime Minister. This is a really tough time. And because it's unprecedented, none of us have experienced it before by definition. As First Minister, I've not gone through a situation like this. So we are all trying to do our best here. We are all trying to pull together as well as we can. And we will all get it wrong on occasion. We'll all make mistakes. That is in the nature of this. But I will end this answer on a point I've made so many times before. We will get through it, and we will get through it better if we all just remember that we all are doing our best, and to look out for each other, to show each other respect, and to show each other kindness, which I'm still not sure we're as good at as we should be. And sometimes when it's most important to show people kindness is when they have made a mistake. So maybe we can all get a bit better at that. Dare I say it, even the media. I'll move on to Rachel Watson at the Daily Mail.
First Minister, you spoke there about the lockdown very briefly, and we're in the third week of that now, and you signalled that this will be for the long term. Or the long haul. I just wondered if you could give us any details on what this might look like going forward. We had Matt Hancock speak earlier this week about suggesting stricter restrictions around daily exercise. And I just wondered if the Scottish Government have had any talks with the government, and if that is, you know, banning this exercise you're allowed once a day going forward. And also just on care homes, Age Scotland had called for an inquiry into the deaths at one of the care homes in Glasgow, and I wondered if you were supportive of that.
Well, on that latter point, the care inspectorate will be notified and will do whatever investigation they need to do in the case of deaths in care homes, and I think it's appropriate that happens. On the first part of your question, I can't say for certain what the future, and by that I mean the next few weeks and months, look like in terms of these measures, because we aren't yet, firstly, in a position to know exactly what the impact of the current measures have been, what impact that has had on the spread of the virus. Hopefully that certainty will grow over the next few days and feed into that review that I've spoken about. I've always said that if more restrictive measures are required in the interest of beating the virus, we will have to contemplate that. We are not, I'm not standing here right now with any secret plans to do that. If we do get into that situation, I will stand here and I will tell people that and give the reasons for it. But I hope over a period of weeks, perhaps when some of this, it will be months, that we see a process become possible where we start to get back to normal. But I've always been really clear not to give people false promise and false expectation about the timescale of that. In order to get on top of this virus and stay on top of this virus, some of these measures at least are likely to be in place for a considerable period of time. And it's important that as we understand this more and as we are able to take those decisions, I and colleagues can stand here and explain to the public why those decisions have been reached and what then we're asking people to do. But right now, what we can't forget is what we're asking people to do now, which is follow the advice that I spoke about earlier on. Chris Green from The Independent.
From the IAS, First Minister.
Sorry, my apologies.
Right. Yeah, also on the lockdown, I mean, we're still seeing pictures almost daily of people parked at beauty spots or maybe playing sport or something like that in parks. And I just wondered, what goes through your mind when you see those pictures of people?
Look, the vast majority of people, in my experience, are doing their level best to follow the advice. People will make mistakes and get it wrong, and it's important when that happens, they understand that and don't repeat that. Of course, there'll be instances of people exercising in a park where that is perfectly okay because they're following all of the advice. It will be their one exercise session a day. They'll be following all the social distancing advice, and that is fine. So don't assume that everybody you see out in public is breaching the advice, but people should not be congregating together outside their household groups. Crowded places are not safe places to be, and right now they're not legitimate places to be, whether that is inside or outside. So please follow the advice. Stay at home, unless it is for essential work purposes or for the limited reasons we are saying to people it's okay to leave home to get essential supplies or to do your one exercise session in a day. And when you're outside of your own home, make sure you're complying with all the social distancing rules that are in place. David Ball from The Herald.
Thank you, First Minister. The daily numbers that are issued are obviously underestimates. What confidence does that give you that we will know for certain when we reach the peak of this outbreak and the restrictions could potentially be removed rather than being done too early?
Well, we're doing a range of different things to understand the spread of this virus. So the numbers I give here are part of that, but they're not the totality of that. And particularly on deaths, we've always been very clear to say that these are, every single one is a tragedy, but these are deaths of people who had a laboratory confirmed case of the virus. From tomorrow, we'll give a much more comprehensive overview of the numbers of people who have sadly died from COVID, where that's not just confirmed but presumed, so where a doctor has put a reference to it on the death certificate. We're doing modelling. And as I say, with every day that passes, that model moves from being a pure computer model, which we've been relying on in an earlier stage, to one that is populated by real data. And that will give us a much greater understanding of the spread of the virus and when it's likely to peak. And then we'll inform the decisions we have to make about getting ourselves out of where we are just now and back to something that is closer to normality. I would just say two final points there. Again, to caution people, it's not to depress people or make people feel, oh my goodness, this is going on, you know, longer than we want. It's to be honest and frank with people. These measures are not about to be lifted next week. We are in this for the long haul. And it may be, we don't know this yet, that when we do start to come out of it, it will not be all at once. It will be a phased approach. But we will make sure we set that out to people clearly and based on the best possible advice and information we've got. And the second point to make is people understandably fixate a lot on this question of the peak, and that is obviously important, but it is not the case, and people should not get the impression that as soon as the peak of the infection is over, we just go back to normal. Because, you know, people can think of what a peak, there's a long lead into a peak, and then there's a long way out of a peak. And while you're coming out of that peak, it is also really important that we make sure things stay on a downward trajectory. So the peak is important, but it is not the case that when we get to that point, everything goes back to normal. And as I say, I'm not saying that to make people feel anxious on a sunny day, but simply to continue to be open about the fact that this is something we need to stick with in order that we don't just keep this virus at bay for a little while, but we actually effectively stop it overwhelming our NHS and leading to the deaths of more people than would otherwise be the case. And lastly, I've got Christine Lavelle from The Sun.
First Minister, we've heard this morning that Michael Gove is isolating because a family member has symptoms of the virus. I just wanted to ask, how has this virus affected your own ministers, and are any of them having to isolate because they're showing symptoms?
There was a minister earlier on who isolated because a family member was showing symptoms. So, you know, these things will happen. I made the point earlier in relation to the Prime Minister. I know people sometimes struggle with the notion that politicians are human, but we are human. We are as susceptible as anybody else to getting this virus. So we will have cases of this. I'm encouraging my ministers to work from home as much as possible. I and the Health Secretary in particular can't always do that because we have to be here, amongst other things, giving these updates. But even us, we're trying to make sure our arrangements are such that we're minimising the risk of contracting this virus and minimising the risk of us passing it on to other people. So this is affecting us just as it is affecting everybody else. There will be differences in exactly how it's affecting different people, but none of us are immune from this, if that's not the wrong word to use, because immunity is obviously a complicated concept in the context of a virus. But none of us escape this. We're all in this together. We're all as susceptible as anybody else of getting it and being affected by it. But it also means that all of us must do the right thing to give us the best possible chance of beating it. So I think that's probably an appropriate place to end. Can I thank all of you, not just the journalists, but all of you at home who have been watching this. I hope you found the updates today useful, and we'll see you again tomorrow at the same time.